This series of episodes is brought to you by the Field Museum, the Harvard Museum of Comparative Zoology, and the National Science Foundation. Hey, we're back here at the Museum of Comparative Zoology with Dr. Stephanie Pierce. Stephanie, what do you do here at the museum?
Well, I'm the curator of vertebrate paleontology, and I study the anatomy and function of both modern and extinct animals.
And today we're going to talk about that bending experiment that they just did. Yeah.
Yay.
So in our last episode, Katrina and I were focusing kind of on the vertebral column of that fissure. And once the camera stopped rolling, what happened next?
Well, after you get the vertebral column out is really when the science begins. What we did is we took that vertebral column and we separated it out into joints. And so a joint is composed of two vertebrae. Mm-hmm. So you have one bony process in the front, one in the back. In between, there's a joint. And those joints allow the vertebrae to move.
So you have like little duos of little vertebral sections.
Exactly.
Okay. And so what was part of that process?
We stick some screws in it. So mm-hmm. we stick a screw in one vertebra and a screw in the other vertebra, and then we sort of crank it into this rig to give it some rigidity. We stick some pins on the top, and those pins are going to allow us to look if there's any movement while we stick some weights on one of the screws. So we do it in small increments so that we can understand the process by which the vertebrae actually move with respect to one another.
And so putting the weights on it, what did you guys learn about this particular set of vertebrae?
Well, the interesting thing about the lumbar vertebrae is that they are really mobile, but it takes a lot of mass or a lot of force in order to get the vertebrae to move. When you want to move really fast, so in a mammal, when they want to gallop and run really fast, like a cheetah, mm-hmm. they can actually use those big muscles in their back, like you saw in the Fisher cat, to create a lot of force and move those joints in the lumbar region.
Well, you know, this all comes back to like looking at proto-mammals or fossil mammals, and they don't seem to have that lumbar region. How do you compare what we did with the living fissure, or, you know, it's dead, but the version of a living mammal, and compare that to that of a fossil animal?
It's actually not that easy, but luckily, we have a lot of new technology that helps us out. So the first thing we need to do is we need to isolate the vertebral column in our fossils. Well, one way we can do that is by doing CT scanning. And then what the CT scan allows us to do is look at the difference between the fossil and the rock, and then we can actually pull that fossil out of the rock virtually. So we can take a CT scan model, we can make a virtual replication of the vertebral column, and we can conduct a virtual bending experiment.
Cool. So once you get the CT scan model into your computer software, how can you perform that kind of similar experiment?
I actually use gaming software.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So the gaming industry is really great for 3D modeling. And what we're actually doing here is making 3D models. When a vertebral column goes in, a lot of times it's not in its best form. It doesn't look pretty.
Yeah.
Here's one model where it was sort of just put in and it's kind of all over the place.
It's a little scoliosis-like.
Exactly. And here's the same animal, but all the vertebrae are put into place. And once we get into a reasonable shape, mm-hmm. we can start to play around with it. You remember back to our bending experiment, we had two vertebrae mm-hmm. and it had a joint in between, and we were trying to experiment with how that joint moved.
Right.
Well, here we have two vertebrae and there's a joint in between it. So what we can start to do is that we can start to manipulate this. We can use the software to move things with respect to one another.
So how do you know that you're not going like to an extreme? Because you can bend it pretty far one way, but that seems like that might be a little, you know, gratuitous of the software you're using.
As a scientist, if you're doing something like this, you really have to pay attention. You could just do whatever you wanted. It's virtual. But what you want to do is really look at the anatomy of the vertebral column or of those joints. Mm-hmm. And if you, for instance, disarticulate a joint, it might tell you that maybe you've gone a little bit too far. Or if you start to merge one bone into another, you also might have gone a bit too far. So sometimes we call this disarticulation and bony stops. When we look at our normal bending experiments, we can say, okay, so this joint can move this much, and this is the anatomy of those vertebrae. And so we can make correlations between the anatomy of the vertebra and how much that vertebra can bend. And that will give us some sort of bound.
So you're not only looking at this Fisher cat, you're also looking at a number of other animals that are still alive, right?
Yeah, that's right. We're looking at a variety of different animals that have different morphologies. So mm-hmm. we're looking at things like lizards and monotremes and marsupials and a variety of placental mammals too, like the Fisher cat. By looking at a variety of modern animals and doing all these bending experiments, we can understand how their joints actually function. And then we can do virtual bending experiments on the same animals and put it under the same parameters as our fossils.
I see.
And we can compare that. We call this validating our experiment.
Yeah.
And so if the bending experiment and the virtual bending experiment in the modern animals match up really well, we can be pretty confident that our virtual experiments and our fossils are giving us a pretty good indication of the type of mobility and the potential for locomotion behavior.
So what's the ultimate goal of all of this research?
Well, our ultimate goal is to really track the evolution of the vertebral column through the fossil animals that lead up to modern mammals, test how much regionalization is in their vertebral column and how that correlates with function. And hopefully we'll try to pinpoint the time at which the mammalian type regionalization and locomotion style evolved.
That's so exciting. I mean, you're looking at fossil evidence that was probably collected, you know, in the last, you know, 50 to 100 years. You're being able to manipulate it using computer software without doing any damage to the specimen, and you're able to make inferences about the mobility and gait of animals that lived hundreds of millions of years ago.
I think right now is one of the best times to be a vertebrate paleontologist.
Yeah. I mean, that's pretty exciting.
I think it's pretty exciting.
It still has brains on it.